Hello there, you're watching Talking Europe. I'm Catherine Nicholson. Thanks very much for being with us. Now, I don't know about where you live in the world, but here in Northern Europe, we have had some very odd weather events in the last few months of the year, including, of course, torrential rainfall and deadly floods in the last few months, which scientists say were a direct consequence of climate change, something to very much focus the mind ahead of the United Nations Climate Summit, aka COP26. Now, as we broadcast this programme, the conference just getting going in Glasgow in the UK. One overarching question really is, will world leaders commit to policy changes that will have a real impact on slowing down global warming? There are, of course, so many elements to this, so we wanted to focus on just a couple of battlegrounds that are playing out in Europe. With us today for that, three members of the European Parliament. I have on my left Jürgen Valbon from Sweden. Hi there.
Hi.
A member of the centre-right European People's Party. On my right, we have from the Netherlands, Mohamed Shahim, who's an MEP from the centre-left Socialists and Democrats group. You're also on the Parliament's Environment Committee as well.
Yes.
And we have from Spain, Vice Chair of the Greens at the European Parliament, Ernest Utterson. Thanks for being on the programme.
Thank you.
So I just want to start off really just a brief overview of where you think Europe is in the climate conversation. Ursula von der Leyen wants the European Union to be a world leader in climate policy. Just briefly, is the EU a leader in this?
Well, I think it is a very important statement from her, and I think we have to do a lot of change in Europe. This transition is very important, and of course the European Union has the change of climate, but also on digitalization and competitiveness in a way. Very important topics.
I think the simple answer is yes. We went from a vision to a set of legislations with the Fit for 55 package. So it's not only to talk the talk, it's also walk the walk. So I think the EU is, if you compare that to other regions in the world, is the furthest front, or the real front runners, yes.
Do you share this optimism, Ernest Utterson?
Of course, we would like Europe to do more at home, but I agree, Europe is a key player, and the key element for the COP is whether Europe will manage to gather around other countries in order to increase the ambition, because we need to increase the ambition at global level.
Okay, well, let's, like I said, look at one particular angle, because there are so many to look at. So energy production is a massive discussion, and one of the big disagreements here in the European Union at the moment is what should we class as green energy? It might seem obvious, but there are disagreements. Jürgen Valbon, you've joined a call from more than 80 MEPs to get nuclear classed as a green energy source by the European Commission. Why? Why do you take that stance?
Because, as we said, it is very important that we do the transition, and we will need a lot of new energy sources. And nuclear is emissions-free. So we will need more wind, we will need more solar power, but we also need a lot new nuclear. And with the discussions we have today with the taxonomy, it is evident that if we do not let nuclear be within the taxonomy, there will be more emissions, basically. And we have phased out it a bit in the nuclear already in Sweden, and I think we should revise that, and we should instead research more and build more nuclear power plants.
Mohamed Shahim, I know that you're against the building of new nuclear power plants.
I believe that the debate that we have here in this House and the European Parliament is very shallow when it comes to nuclear. I've seen the motions or the amendments for within resolutions or within certain reports where people state they want to have more nuclear. And I always tell them, nuclear has never been off the table. If you look at the energy mix of the EU in 2050, there's always 10 to 50% nuclear. The question is, do we want to invest the limited amount of resources we have in a technology that's, if we look at current technology of nuclear, current generation of nuclear, that's very costly? I think it's not a smart idea. I think it's better to put money in innovation and when it comes to the future technologies like nuclear fusion, etc., and let's wait it out. Another problem is the market is open to do whatever they want, but the conditions of the market are really crazy. If we look at the UK, the latest plant that the Energy de France has built, they've asked, I think, 11 cents per kilowatt hour price guarantee for 35 years. I mean, this is not the investments we want taxpayers to support.
You wanted to respond to that.
Yes, because at first it sounds like we can agree. You would like to have more research and development, and so do I, especially the smaller module nuclear reactors. If we put investment in research and development investment in that from the European Union, I think we can produce cheaper and safer and better nuclear. So I think that is excellent. The other part you mentioned was the private investment and the taxonomy. That is the important part here, that we have to channel private investment to nuclear as well, to a lot of energy sources, but to nuclear as well. And that's why you have to include nuclear in the taxonomy.
I think that nuclear cannot be an option. I mean, the taxonomy very clearly talks about new technologies. Nuclear is not a new technology, it's an old technology. Also, there's an issue that we haven't been able to solve with nuclear, which is the radioactive waste, which is something that we will let for the future generations for centuries, and this has no solution at the moment. And also, I have to say that the problem with nuclear, as it has been mentioned before, is that it's simply too costly, and we have few resources. I mean, a nuclear investment only works with a massive public subsidy. And I'm even, so that's why I'm against including nuclear in the, as labeling it as a green technology. But also, even if we do that, I'm still not sure that the private investment would go there, because it's simply not an investment that works.
Mr. Shaheem, agreeing with you. Mr. Babon, you disagree.
Well, so in that case, let's include it in the taxonomy, and then we'll see if the private investment will follow or not. Because that is the choice. If we do not include it there, then we do not channel the private investment to nuclear. If it is old or new, it doesn't matter. It's emissions free. And that is what you disregard. We have to take care of the climate so that we can have a better situation in the future. And then we need all the decarbonized energy sources, and nuclear is one of them. When it comes to the waste, you put that, you had that as well. It is not true that it is not solved. It is solved. It is solved in Finland. They have now taken the decision. In Sweden, we have a decision made by the experts with the same methodology as they have adopted in Finland. The only thing that we are waiting for in Sweden is the governmental decision, and that is a Social Democrat and a Green in that government. So it is solved.
Nuclears are producing massive amounts of radioactive waste. We don't know what to do with them, and that is going to be for the future generations.
It's solved.
Secondly, a taxonomy is for new technologies, not for old technologies. And of course, nuclear is the nuclear plants that we have now will be working in the coming years to secure and to play a role for the transition that we know. I mean, we're not telling to close all the nuclear power plants tomorrow. It's not what we say. What we say is that future investments need to go to purely renewables, and this is what we need to do.
So a question would be, can other types of renewables replace nuclear? France, for example, quite an extreme example perhaps, gets about 70% of its energy from nuclear, has one of the lowest per capita carbon emissions rates in the EU. It's not feasible that could be replaced quickly by, for example, wind power or solar, is it?
I mean, there's no one-size-fits-all solution for every member state. Let's be very clear on that. The issue that I have with the debate on nuclear is that it doesn't bring us into the right direction of decarbonization in general. If we look at the whole system, we approximately use, let's say, 20-25% of our energy mix is electricity. We still have 75% or 80% what I call energy atoms. We need to find sustainable alternatives for fossil fuels. For that, we need massive investments in production of, for example, hydrogen, ammonia, methanol, and also the infrastructure. What I'm really afraid of is that instead of investing in these future needed technologies for our industry, for aviation, for maritime, we are stick to a debate with no result. People are too dogmatic. Within this position, people say nuclear is the solution for everything. Others say nuclear is a no-go. I'm saying this current technology, even small modular reactors, is not looking very promising. What I'm saying is we have two very promising technologies. No, it's one technology, but two sites that are being built in southern France with nuclear fusion and one in the UK. Let's see what that brings us. There are still some solutions, problems that we have to resolve, but that's at least a nuclear technology without the same waste as the older technology, and that could maybe help us in the energy transition. But we're talking about a timeline past 2040, maybe even later.
And that is why we should go for these small modular reactors, because you said that it is new against old, and I don't agree with that. It doesn't matter if it's old or new technology. The most important part is that it does not create CO2 emissions. Mm. And that is what we need to combat climate change.
Well, just to pick up on that point, because we're running out of time, you know, scientists are saying, you know, time is running out. We're racing towards deadlines. Can we really meet them? Is it perhaps a compromise in terms of the carbon emissions to go in the direction Mr. Valbon's saying?
We need to go faster, that's clear. So with the current path that we have, emissions will increase by 16% from here to 2030, and we need them to decrease by 45%. That is why the negotiations that are starting now in the COP are so important. We need greater ambition. But that doesn't mean having to rely on all technologies that still create another sort of problem. The sort of problem is the nuclear waste and the problems with safety, because we have all very quickly forgotten what happened in Fukushima. But the safety issues of the nuclear is something that is still not solved. So more ambition, but let's invest in new technology.
A very brief point for Mr. Shame to finish.
No, practically, if I look at the last two plants that are being built, one in Finland, if I'm not mistaken, they started in 2000 with the plans, 2005 with the build-up. They're expecting to finish by 2022. So even if we want to push for nuclear, it will not play a big role in the upcoming two decades. I really don't believe that.
And that's why we have to start now. We have to start build nuclear plants now, and we have to research more on the module reactors, and we need to include it in the taxonomy so that we can channel more private money into this sector.
All right.
That is the way we combat the climate change.
There we go. I have to finish there,
yes.
But I did say it was a big debate. It's one that's going to continue. Thank you all very much for taking part
Thank
in this debate
much.
On Talking Europe.
Thanks so much.
And thanks to you for watching as well. We'll, of course, cover COP26 on France 24. See you soon. We're a little late.